Friends, if you want to watch super hit movie The Contractor in English, then you must like this video. If you are visiting our channel for the first time, don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Friends, in today's video, the movie we are going to talk about is called The Contractor. We will talk about what this movie is and where you can watch it. All the interesting facts about this movie, in today's video I am going to tell you. I am also going to give you all the information on which OTT platform or on which satellite channel you will get to watch this movie. Also, we will talk in detail about the technical department, music department, pre-production, filming, post-production, budget, box office collection of this film. We will also talk about the story of this film, and I will also give you a small review of the story of this film. Apart from this, we will discuss about the facts of this film, storyline, star cast, actors' performance in the film and which character has played which role. That's why I request you friends to watch this video till the end, so let's start the video. The Contractor is a 2022 American action thriller film directed by Tarik Saleh in his English language film debut. The film stars Chris Pine, Ben Foster, Gillian Jacobs, Eddie Marsan, J.D. Pardo, Florian Montinu, and Kiefer Sutherland. Filming began in Europe in October 2019. It also filmed in Fort Bragg and wrapped at the end of 2019. The Contractor was released in theaters and on demand in the United States on April 1, 2022, by Paramount Pictures and STXfilms. The film received mixed reviews from critics, grossing $2.1 million at the box office. Movie plot: Sergeant First Class James Harper, a decorated Green Beret, is involuntarily discharged from the Army due to his use of illegal steroids to treat a debilitating knee injury. Facing financial ruin, he contacts his friend Mike, who works with a private military company under the command of fellow veteran Rusty Jennings. Harper is receiving lucrative offers from similar firms, but feels a sense of duty to his country. Mike tells him that Rusty runs clandestine operations for the Department of Defense. Harper agrees to meet Rusty after seeing Mike's opulent house. Harper signs on with Rusty and the team for an operation in Germany. As a sign of good faith, Rusty gives Harper's family $50,000 to help clear their debts. Harper spends most of his tour surveilling a Middle Eastern scientist named Saleh. After analyzing the data, Rusty informs the team that Saleh is working for Al-Qaeda and developing a bio-agent. He tells the team they have been given permission to raid Saleh's laboratory and retrieve all of his research data and then dispose of Saleh. The team easily accesses the lab and acquires the data. Mike orders Harper to finish Saleh, who protests that he is just a scientist working on a cure. Harper follows orders and then departs after setting the lab on fire, carrying Saleh's laptop containing the research data. The team are confronted by the police, and after a prolonged shootout, during which the remaining team members are killed, Harper rescues a wounded Mike and they hide in a nearby storm drain. Mike, believing he is about to die, begs Harper to look after his family and get the data to Rusty. Harper provides a blood transfusion and saves Mike's life. After recuperating, Mike is ready to return to Rusty and the main team, but Harper's knee has given out on him and he needs to rest up. Mike proceeds alone with Saleh's laptop but informs Harper he will be picked up from a specific location after he is sufficiently rested. Harper makes it to the hotel and finds fresh clothes and a note from Mike saying that he went to hand off the laptop. He tries to treat his injured knee and waits for Mike to return. When Mike doesn't come back, Harper leaves the hotel, gets a burner phone, and makes contact with Rusty, who informs him there is a car waiting to exfiltrate him to safety. But Harper senses something is amiss when Rusty tells him that Mike never made it to Berlin. As he delays going to the car, a hit team emerges and they shoot at Harper. Harper evades capture and manages to kill the hit team, who are revealed to be former recon Marines working for Rusty. Before dying, one of the Marines gives Harper intel on a safe house but advises him that he can never return home. Harper visits Saleh's home, threatening Sylvie, Saleh's wife, into providing him with Saleh's computer files. Sylvie gives Harper her husband's iPad, and he leaves for the safe house. After Harper meets Virgil, he is tranquilized and awakens in the safe house. Virgil explains that Harper's knee was infected, and that while it has been treated, Harper still cannot return to his family. Harper plays a video on the iPad in which Saleh explains that he was indeed working on a successful H5N1 vaccine formula that he intends to provide for free, rather than sell to a pharmaceutical company. While Virgil shares dinner with Harper, another of Rusty's fire teams attacks. Virgil is killed, but Harper escapes, setting off a booby trap for Rusty's team. Harper returns to the United States. He tracks down Mike, who explains that Rusty also lied to him and told him Harper had died. Rusty has provided for Harper's family, and Mike advises Harper to disappear. Harper protests. Winning his old friend over, they set up a plan to get revenge on Rusty. Mike gets Harper into Rusty's compound, where they surprise Rusty's guards. While Mike distracts everyone with a frontal attack, Harper infiltrates Rusty's house. Harper manages to terminate Rusty, but not before Rusty has mortally wounded Mike. Harper is finally able to return to his family. Cast: Chris Pine as James Harper, Ben Foster as Mike Hawkins, Gillian Jacobs as Brian Harper, Eddie Marsan as Virgil, J.D. Pardo as Eric, Kiefer Sutherland as Rusty Jennings, Florian Montinu as Kaufman, Nina Haas as Keisha, Amira Kassar as Sylvie, Fares Fares as Salem. Production: The project was announced in May 2019 as Violence of Action, with Chris Pine set to star. In October, Ben Foster and Gillian Jacobs joined the cast. Filming started in October 2019 in the United States and continued in Germany and Romania later in the year. The film is produced by Basil Iwanyk and Erica Lee from Thunder Road Films, with Esther Hornstein co-producing. Executive producers includes 30 West's Dan Friedkin, Micah Green and Dan Steinman, along with Pine, Jonathan Fuhman, Tom Lassily and Josh Bratman. In November 2019, filming in Romania started for around 8 weeks. By December 2019, Eddie Marsan, Nina Haas, Amira Kassar, Fares Fares and J.D. Pardo had joined the film. Filming wrapped by the end of 2019. In November 2021, it was reported that the film had been red-titled The Contractor. Alex Belcher composed the film's score. Sony Classical released the soundtrack. Release: In February 2021, STXfilms acquired distribution rights to the film. The movie was originally scheduled for release on December 10, 2021, but the release was delayed to March 18, 2022. And then to April 1, 2022. In February 2022, it was announced Paramount Pictures and Showtime acquired distribution rights to the film. Paramount will release the film in a simultaneous limited theatrical and premium video on demand release, with the film coming to Paramount Plus and Showtime later in the year. The rights for the film were put in bankruptcy on March 22, 2022, with Migration LLC now owning all worldwide rights to the film excluding United States. The film debuted on Prime Video in select countries on the same day as the US premiere. Box office: In the United States and Canada, The Contractor was released alongside Morbius and was projected to gross less than $1 million from 489 theaters in its opening weekend. It made $560,678 in its first 3 days, finishing 12th at the box office. It added $140,193 in its second weekend. Critical response: The review aggregator Rotten Tomatoes reported an approval rating of 44% based on 88 reviews, with an average rating of 5.5/10. The website's critics' consensus reads, "The Contractor is caught between message movie and standard-issue action thriller, satisfying neither aim despite strong work from a talented cast." Metacritic assigned the film a weighted average score of 52 out of 100 based on 19 critics, indicating mixed or average reviews. The Contractor movie review: There's a lot of discussion lately about the type of films that are released now and what it says about the future of movie. Is it true that all people will go to see in theaters or superhero movies and other familiar IP? If that's the case, my suspicion is that films like The Contractor will become commonplace on streaming services. There's ample evidence that programming old-fashioned series and movies, what could be called dad product, works to find an underserved, usually older fan base who can afford all the streamers. The success of shows like Yellowstone and Bosch means people will probably be drawn to an action movie that not only recalls the time that star Chris Pine played Jack Ryan but reunites the stars of Hell or High Water. Sadly, the promise of The Contractor fizzles after an intriguing setup as the script feels beneath most of the people involved. The talented cast do just enough to make this one more forgettable than horrendous, which means The Contractor 2 seems likely, and so many more movies like it. I hope some of them try harder. The always solid Pine plays Special Forces Sergeant James Harper, an elite agent with a bum knee who gets discharged from the US Army and watches the bills pile up with his wife Brian. That's when his former squadmate and good friend Mike reaches out with a proposal. Mike has been doing off-the-books operations for a veteran named Rusty Jennings. The money is good, the jobs are quick, and it will give James purpose again while providing for his family. As Mike says, "We're all just mercenaries in the end," giving the opening act of The Contractor some weighty dramatic material that the rest of the film doesn't fulfill. It's easy to think about the last time Pine and Foster starred in a drama that hinged on the lie of the American dream. If Hell or High Water was the Western version of that concept, this is the Tom Clancy-inspired one. The problem is that writer J.P. Davis and director Tarik Saleh seem afraid to do anything interesting or unexpected once they have their pieces in place. It's not surprising at all that the mission that James and Mike are contracted for blows up in their face. And only people who have never seen a movie before will be surprised to learn that Rusty isn't telling them everything they need to know. Ultimately, The Contractor becomes depressingly routine. The action isn't interestingly staged, and the plot has less twists in its 100 minutes than your average single episode of a spy drama. It all feels like setup, getting people ready for a series of a film franchise, but so narratively thin on its own that you could recount the plot in like 15 words or less. This all means that the cast has to do a lot of heavy lifting to get this bare-bones film to 2 stars, which they do. They're the real mercenaries here as Pine finds a sadness that balances the heroic approach lesser actors would have taken and proves he still has great chemistry with Foster. Nina Haas is sadly wasted in a small part, but Eddie Marsan gets a great scene that breaks the tedium of the second half with its near-capture escape structure as James tries to find his way home. Other than a remarkable lack of ambition, there's nothing explicitly wrong or dreadful about The Contractor. It checks boxes for what feels like an older audience who misses the days when action movies were made about American heroes instead of super ones. Honestly, those movie watchers deserve better too. Other information about this film. The Bourne movies revivified the espionage genre with their nimble, scrappy, down and dirty action. But they weren't as widely imitated as one might have expected, which leaves The Contractor feeling like a relatively fresh chip off a not-so-old block. Chris Pine stars as a forcibly decommissioned U.S. Army careerist whom financial straits push him into a sketchy private militaristic security job. Needless to say, that goes south in a hurry. Swede Tarik Sale's first American feature is more impersonally commercial than prior projects, and more efficient than memorable as a medium-scaled adventure exercise. Still, being a solid cut above average is good enough, given so much formulaic mediocrity among thrillers cluttering the streaming market. Already released in several territories during March, the film is scheduled for launch to US theaters, digital and on-demand platforms April 1st. Things start out unpromisingly in a rote mode of I love my flag and family sentiments underlining that Special Forces Sergeant James Harper is a straight-up good guy. He's just out of rehab for a serious injury incurred during the last of 4 combat rotations in 5 years, all of which has kept him overmuch from the wife and son he adores. But called into Fort Bragg by the brass, he's brusquely informed that due to a filthy drug test result, he'd been medicating for his painful knee. He is being discharged, effective immediately. It's an honorable, yet his pension, healthcare, and other benefits are abruptly gone along with the paycheck. Creditors were already closing in, so this is not just a bitter injustice, but a financial catastrophe. James has little choice but to hit up a close buddy, his former officer Mike, for leads on the kind of private contractor work he'd sworn he'd never do. As it happens, Mike is currently in the lucrative employ of one Rusty Jennings, whose coffee import-export business is a cover for for-hire covert operations manned by service personnel who have been chewed up and spat out just like our hero. Rusty makes a point of differentiating himself in profane terms from the likes of real-life Blackwater founder Eric Prince, suggesting he, by contrast, solely does the right thing. We deal strictly with matters of national security. He assures, the price is certainly right. A $50,000 check gets cut for James even before he starts. Soon he's on a plane to Berlin, where he spends several days spying on Saleh Mohsen, a Harvard-educated virologist purportedly involved in bioterrorism research funded by Al-Qaeda affiliate. Benny, Mike, and local contact Keisha execute a nocturnal raid of the lab facility, providing this action movie its first real action, well past the half-hour mark. Their mission somewhat messily accomplished, however, they're faced with a police phalanx. After a shootout, James is left alone, weakened and increasingly aware of the extent to which he has been double-crossed. It is this midsection that is the film's strongest suit, as our hero is hunted by both government forces and his own erstwhile allies. More a classic leading man type than a credibly hardened military lifer, Pine nonetheless has the physicality to convince us James can roll with various very hard punches here. Whether underwater, in subterranean tunnels, or at a crowded intersection turned second bullet-riddled melee, his survival strategies are nicely drawn in J.P. Davis' screenplay, and staged with tense but non-hyperbolic resourcefulness by Sale and well-chosen locations. Things slow down a bit when James finds brief refuge in the unlikely form of Eddie Marsan, while the remaining story beats grow more predictable, but satisfying enough nonetheless. Those hoping Pine and the always welcome Foster's reunion would be the class of hell or high water should lower those expectations considerably. Most of the overqualified supporting actors are too briefly seen to be made much use of, with Haas particularly wasted. Still, The Contractor succeeds as a locked and loaded intrigue sufficiently grounded in plausible mercenary-style chicanery worldwide. And that industry's exploitation of ex-military personnel, while avoiding any heavy political messaging. Of course, Eric Prince may disagree, ostensibly set mostly in Germany. The well-turned production manages to pass muster with a disguised, primarily Romanian shoot. DP Pierre Aime's widescreen images and editor Thais Schmidt's pacing are adept, while Alex Belcher's original score is at its most effective when stripped down to an urgent electronic pulse. More details, for me, There is nothing in this world more important than protecting and providing for those I love most, which is exactly why Chris Pine's new military drama The Contractor hits so close to home. Even if, like me, you can't relate to the career background of Pine's Special Forces Sergeant James Harper, there's a lot that resonates in his painful story and the unfair cards he's dealt. And Pine's performance shines through as he carries the heavy weight of his character's past on screen. Even though the ending and certain action scenes fell a little short of the high bar set by the rest of the film, James Harper's journey remains a largely compelling one. Refreshingly, instead of jumping straight into the action and explosions as some military thrillers tend to do, it spends nearly an hour setting the scene before a single bullet is fired. That time is spent introducing us to Pine's James, his wife Brian, and their son Jack, showing a loving family whose happy lifestyle is being threatened by ever-growing debt and an honorable discharge that James wanted no part in. Fans of edge-of-your-seat gunfights need not worry as The Contractor eventually has plenty of them, but the time it takes at the beginning grounds the story, the stakes, and it lends much more meaning to what happens next. Even scenes that might play out as casual pillow talk demonstrate what's at stake here, including one where Brian and James discuss the death of a friend who was also in the military. It is presented as not some shocking revelation, but instead as a regular part of their lives, and the normalcy with which they talk about it makes it ever more disturbing. It's moments like these, coupled with shots of James and Jack playing in the backyard or being filmed by Brian in the pool, that paint a picture of a family with a pretty universal want to live their lives free of struggle and tragedy. It gives The Contractor a certain amount of relatability in what could have been instead have been 103 minutes of bullets flying with far fewer emotional stakes. This effort is aided by its cast, and Pine was a more than worthy choice for the lead. Pine sinks with the weight of a life filled with pain, both mental and physical, in large part due to a severe knee injury and the fallout from a toxic relationship with a father he is trying not to become, and he portrays Harper's heavy baggage wonderfully. He was also clearly up to the task when it came to the action scenes, as I never questioned whether he was a soldier who had committed his whole life to perfecting his lethal skills. Ben Foster, who plays James' best friend and former superior, is another standout in The Contractor. The chemistry between them that we've seen in prior collaborations like Hell or High Water is on full display here, selling a brotherly trust and banter that extends far beyond the story that's on the surface. Kiefer Sutherland, meanwhile, plays Rusty, the leader of a team running covert, off-the-book missions to protect national security alongside the seemingly lovely Spring Lake Coffee Roastery. It's no fault of Sutherland's, who, on the surface, fits perfectly into the role of a gruff and seasoned vet with a heart, but this character ends up as one of the film's weaker aspects. Rusty doesn't get enough screen time to become anything more than two-dimensional, standing as a pretty thin element in an otherwise layered story, which could also be said of the ending. It's hard to discuss without getting too deep into spoilers, but I was left feeling conflicted as the credits rolled, and not in a great way. The way it all wrapped up felt a little too tidy. And that's not to say James and co. saw a happy or sad conclusion or anything in between. Instead, the final moments simply felt at odds with the rest of the film. It didn't feel truly earned, happened way too quickly, and left little to imagination. All that aside, the journey to that underwhelming conclusion is an exciting one, filled with mostly solid action, shocking twists, and a mirror that presents us with a simple question: are you sure everything is as it seems? It's no spoiler to say that the answer is clearly no, or we wouldn't have much of a film. But there are plenty of surprises and adrenaline-filled moments that more than make up for that obvious truth. On that note, while many of the action scenes carried the heft of a big-budget blockbuster, others weren't quite as sleek and briefly took me out of the immersion. There was one close quarters fight in particular that gave me a headache with how many jump cuts there were, some of which would cut away too fast and return farther ahead than they logically should have. Another scene saw a veteran making a very questionable decision for someone of his experience level, followed by a fist fight where a few blows that sounded like they hit the target clearly missed on screen. In the end, however, The Contractor is more memorable for the focus it puts on the people and families impacted by war, and it's all the better for it. While any particular fight in the movie might not be discussed years down the line, its message, one about the hard truths its characters are forced to learn, and the willingness to give everything for those you love, is timeless. Positive elements. If James takes pride in his military service, his greatest joys are actually back home, his wife, Brian, and his son, Jack. It's not easy being a family man and a military man. We hear some sad stories of soldiers leaving their families, and James never wanted to be such a story himself. He made a promise, he tells someone, "Never forsake my family," and he means it. James begins to question his marching orders, too. The movie doesn't quite answer whether he would have fought against the nefarious plot that's been set in motion if he didn't have to. He was as much fighting to survive as to rectify any wrongs. But the fact that he does battle against some pretty terrible goals should still be lauded. spiritual elements. James seems to be a man of faith, as are others in the film. He's in church when the pastor blesses a trio of soldiers as they head off on assignment. "May God bless you and protect you," the pastor says, praying over the soldiers as the rest of the congregation also bows their heads. Only James stares forward, lost in thought, as if wishing he could go, too. When Mike invites James for dinner, Mike's family clasps hands for a dinnertime blessing. "Thank you for this food, and thank you for bringing Uncle James back safely," Mike says. James shares a dinnertime prayer with an unexpected rescuer, too. The scientist, Salim Mohammed Mohsen, is rumored to have connections with Al-Qaeda. But when James talks with him, he says, "I don't believe in God. I believe in science." Someone compares a mission locale with Eden, and says its mountains looked like they were holding up heaven. Sexual content. James and his wife kiss once or twice, including when James briefly cuddles up with her in bed. It's not a sexual scene. He simply gives her a check, an advance on his contract work, and essentially says goodbye. We see James shirtless several times. In one scene, he lies in a bathtub, and the camera views him from the side, a gun resting on his exposed hip. Violent content. As you might expect, The Contractor is plenty violent, and we are exposed to some graphic scenes. In one such scene, a man bashes another to death with a rock. While we don't see most of the blows, we do see the victim's head afterwards, looking as much like a rotting cabbage as it does an identifiable face. Other deaths are less grotesque, though we do see several people shot through the head. The deaths are accompanied by sprays of blood. Victims are shot elsewhere, and some die. The shootout with police leaves several lifeless people strewn on the ground. Other gunshot victims bleed slowly from their midsections, leaving clothes and hands bloody. Some eventually bleed out, though James saves one by transfusing some of his own blood into the victim. Characters die via explosion. One motorcycle rider gets struck with a cinder block. Another is stabbed in the gut and spends several movie minutes slumped helplessly against a wall. A man apparently dies after being injected with a drug underneath a fingernail. Evidence of how he died is covered up with a dramatic explosion, which also kills a security guard and loads of laboratory animals. James' injured knee is pretty grotesque. We see just how bad it is, and we learn that he aggravates the injury during the course of his adventures. Sometimes he's forced to stick a syringe in the thing to suck out fluid building up there. A young boy receives a real tattoo for his birthday, and he suffers through the procedure. Threats are made. A vehicle is set on fire. A man gets knocked out via an injection. We hear about the suicide of a fellow ranger, and it's suggested his self-inflicted death isn't the first one that James and his family have had to deal with. Such deaths, it seems, are euphemistically dealt with by telling others that the soldier died in his sleep. Drug and alcohol content. The scientist smokes. James and Mike share a beer after dinner one evening, and Mike suggests they go out for another once the current mission is over. James takes a number of drugs to deal with the pain in his knee. We see him pop pills and inject himself with some sort of drug. When James gets called in to face his new commanding officer, he's told that his blood is filthy with evidence of the stuff. Other negative elements. James lies to his wife about his job, telling her that he'll be just babysitting corporate executives. "Not dangerous at all," he says, though she knows he's lying. Lies and betrayal are an integral part of the titular contractor's plot, though the movie certainly doesn't condone either. Conclusion. The Contractor deals, slightly, with the entwined issues of physical trauma and mental health in the military. James, we see, is struggling with both. His knee is torn apart. His mind, the movie suggests, is slowly crumbling. His wife finds him on the family roof in the middle of the night, putting a few more shingles in it before the weather comes. After James and Mike go to the funeral of a fellow ranger who committed suicide, Mike asks James how he's doing. "I'm fine," James says. Mike reminds him that that's just what their late friend said, too, right before he took his own life. Rusty even uses that trauma as a selling tool for James. "We gave our minds, our bodies, our spirits, and they chewed us up and spit us out. It's okay," James is told, "to use the skills the military gave him for a big payday or two. It's okay to cash in," Mike tells him. But let's not mistake The Contractor for an issues-related think pick. Setting those fairly superficial ruminations aside, this is a straightforward, R-rated actioner, frenetic and profane and, at times, pretty bloody. The Contractor does want us to consider the issues of mental health in the military. It seems, gratifyingly, to understand the importance of faith to many who serve. But the story is more about prey than prayer, and the movie's many predators take down many a person, both innocent and guilty, with extreme prejudice. This film directed by Tarik Saleh, written by J.P. Davis, produced by Basil Iwanyk, Erica Lee, starring Chris Pine, Ben Foster, Gillian Jacobs, Eddie Marsan, J.D. Pardo, Florian Montinu, Kiefer Sutherland, cinematography, Pierre Aim, edited by Thais Schmidt, music by Alex Belcher, production companies, Thunder Road Films, 30 West, distributed by Paramount Pictures, STX Films. Release date, April 1, 2022. Running time, 103 minutes. Country, United States. Language, English. Box office, $2.1 million. The Contractor is a 2022 American action thriller film directed by Tarik Saleh in his English-language film debut. The film stars Chris Pine, Ben Foster, Gillian Jacobs, Eddie Marsan, J.D. Pardo, Florian Montinu, and Kiefer Sutherland. Filming began in Europe in October 2019. It also filmed in Fort Bragg and wrapped at the end of 2019. The Contractor was released in theaters and on demand in the United States on April 1, 2022, by Paramount Pictures and STX Films. The film received mixed reviews from critics, grossing $2.1 million at the box office. Movie plot. Sergeant First Class James Harper, a decorated Green Beret, is involuntarily discharged from the Army due to his use of illegal steroids to treat a debilitating knee injury. Facing financial ruin, he contacts his friend Mike, who works with a private military company under the command of fellow veteran Rusty Jennings. Harper is receiving lucrative offers from similar firms, but feels a sense of duty to his country. Mike tells him that Rusty runs clandestine operations for the Department of Defense. Harper agrees to meet Rusty after seeing Mike's opulent house. Harper signs on with Rusty and the team for an operation in Germany. As a sign of good faith, Rusty gives Harper's family $50,000 to help clear their debts. Harper spends most of his tour surveilling a Middle Eastern scientist named Saleh. After analyzing the data, Rusty informs the team that Saleh is working for Al-Qaeda and developing a bio-agent. He tells the team they have been given permission to raid Saleh's laboratory and retrieve all of his research data and then dispose of Saleh. The team easily accesses the lab and acquires the data. Mike orders Harper to finish Saleh, who protests that he is just a scientist working on a cure. Harper follows orders and then departs after setting the lab on fire, carrying Saleh's laptop containing the research data. The team are confronted by the police, and after a prolonged shootout, during which the remaining team members are killed, Harper rescues a wounded Mike and they hide in a nearby storm drain. Mike, believing he is about to die, begs Harper to look after his family and get the data to Rusty. Harper provides a blood transfusion and saves Mike's life. After recuperating, Mike is ready to return to Rusty and the main team, but Harper's knee has given out on him and he needs to rest up. Mike proceeds alone with Saleh's laptop but informs Harper he will be picked up from a specific location after he is sufficiently rested. Harper makes it to the hotel and finds fresh clothes and a note from Mike saying that he went to hand off the laptop. He tries to treat his injured knee and waits for Mike to return. When Mike doesn't come back, Harper leaves the hotel, gets a burner phone, and makes contact with Rusty, who informs him there is a car waiting to exfiltrate him to safety. But Harper senses something is amiss when Rusty tells him that Mike never made it to Berlin. As he delays going to the car, a hit team emerges and they shoot at Harper. Harper evades capture and manages to kill the hit team, who are revealed to be former recon Marines working for Rusty. Before dying, one of the Marines gives Harper intel on a safe house but advises him that he can never return home. Harper visits Saleh's home, threatening Sylvie, Saleh's wife, into providing him with Saleh's computer files. Sylvie gives Harper her husband's iPad, and he leaves for the safe house. After Harper meets Virgil, he is tranquilized and awakens in the safe house. Virgil explains that Harper's knee was infected, and that while it has been treated, Harper still cannot return to his family. Harper plays a video on the iPad in which Saleh explains that he was indeed working on a successful H5N1 vaccine formula that he intends to provide for free, rather than sell to a pharmaceutical company. While Virgil shares dinner with Harper, another of Rusty's fire teams attacks. Virgil is killed, but Harper escapes, setting off a booby trap for Rusty's team. Harper returns to the United States. He tracks down Mike, who explains that Rusty also lied to him and told him Harper had died. Rusty has provided for Harper's family, and Mike advises Harper to disappear. Harper protests. Winning his old friend over, they set up a plan to get revenge on Rusty. Mike gets Harper into Rusty's compound, where they surprise Rusty's guards. While Mike distracts everyone with a frontal attack, Harper infiltrates Rusty's house. Harper manages to terminate Rusty, but not before Rusty has mortally wounded Mike. Harper is finally able to return to his family. Cast: Chris Pine as James Harper, Ben Foster as Mike Hawkins, Gillian Jacobs as Brian Harper, Eddie Marsan as Virgil, J.D. Pardo as Eric, Kiefer Sutherland as Rusty Jennings, Florian Montinu as Kaufman, Nina Haas as Keisha, Amira Kassar as Sylvie, Fares Fares as Saleh. Production: the project was announced in May 2019 as Violence of Action, with Chris Pine set to star. In October, Ben Foster and Gillian Jacobs joined the cast. Filming started in October 2019 in the United States, and continued in Germany and Romania later in the year. The film is produced by Basil Iwanyk and Erica Lee from Thunder Road Films with Esther Hornstein co-producing. Executive producers includes 30 West's Dan Friedkin, Micah Green and Dan Steinman, along with Pine, Jonathan Fuhman, Tom Lassily and Josh Bratman. In November 2019, filming in Romania started for around 8 weeks. By December 2019, Eddie Marsan, Nina Haas, Amira Kassar, Fares Fares and J.D. Pardo had joined the film. Filming wrapped by the end of 2019. In November 2021, it was reported that the film had been red-idled. The Contractor. Alex Belcher composed the film's score. Sony Classical released the soundtrack. Release. In February 2021, STXfilms acquired distribution rights to the film. The movie was originally scheduled for release on December 10, 2021, but the release was delayed to March 18, 2022, and then to April 1, 2022. In February 2022, it was announced Paramount Pictures and Showtime acquired distribution rights to the film. Paramount will release the film in a simultaneous limited theatrical and premium video on demand release, with the film coming to Paramount Plus and Showtime later in the year. The rights for the film were put in bankruptcy on March 22, 2022, with Migration, LLC now owning all worldwide rights to the film excluding United States. The film debuted on Prime Video in select countries on the same day as the US premiere. Box office. In the United States and Canada, The Contractor was released alongside Morbius and was projected to gross less than $1 million from 489 theaters in its opening weekend. It made $560,678 in its first 3 days, finishing 12th at the box office. It added $140,193 in its second weekend. Critical response. The review aggregator Rotten Tomatoes reported an approval rating of 44% based on 88 reviews, with an average rating of 5.5/10. The website's critics' consensus reads, "The Contractor is caught between message movie and standard-issue action thriller, satisfying neither aim despite strong work from a talented cast." Metacritic assigned the film a weighted average score of 52 out of 100 based on 19 critics, indicating mixed or average reviews. The Contractor movie review. There's a lot of discussion lately about the type of films that are released now and what it says about the future of movie. Is it true that all people will go to see in theaters are superhero movies and other familiar IP? If that's the case, my suspicion is that films like The Contractor will become commonplace on streaming services. There's ample evidence that programming old-fashioned series and movies, what could be called dad product, works to find an underserved, usually older fan base who can afford all the streamers. The success of shows like Yellowstone and Bosch means people will probably be drawn to an action movie that not only recalls the time that star Chris Pine played Jack Ryan but reunites the stars of Hell or High Water. Sadly, the promise of The Contractor fizzles after an intriguing setup as the script feels beneath most of the people involved. The talented cast do just enough to make this one more forgettable than horrendous, which means The Contractor 2 seems likely, and so many more movies like it. I hope some of them try harder. The always solid Pine plays Special Forces Sergeant James Harper, an elite agent with a bum knee who gets discharged from the US Army and watches the bills pile up with his wife Brian. That's when his former squadmate and good friend Mike reaches out with a proposal. Mike has been doing off-the-books operations for a veteran named Rusty Jennings. The money is good, the jobs are quick, and it will give James purpose again while providing for his family. As Mike says, we're all just mercenaries in the end, giving the opening act of The Contractor some weighty dramatic material that the rest of the film doesn't fulfill. It's easy to think about the last time Pine and Foster starred in a drama that hinged on the lie of the American dream. If Hell or High Water was the Western version of that concept, this is the Tom Clancy-inspired one. The problem is that writer J.P. Davis and director Tarik Saleh seem afraid to do anything interesting or unexpected once they have their pieces in place. It's not surprising at all that the mission that James and Mike are contracted for blows up in their face. And only people who have never seen a movie before will be surprised to learn that Rusty isn't telling them everything they need to know. Ultimately, The Contractor becomes depressingly routine. The action isn't interestingly staged, and the plot has less twists in its 100 minutes than your average single episode of a spy drama. It all feels like setup, getting people ready for a series of a film franchise, but so narratively thin on its own that you could recount the plot in like 15 words or less. This all means that the cast has to do a lot of heavy lifting to get this bare-bones film to 2 stars, which they do. They're the real mercenaries here, as Pine finds a sadness that balances the heroic approach lesser actors would have taken and proves he still has great chemistry with Foster. Nina Haas is sadly wasted in a small part, but Eddie Marsan gets a great scene that breaks the tedium of the second half with its near-capture, escape structure as James tries to find his way home. other than a remarkable lack of ambition. There's nothing explicitly wrong or dreadful about The Contractor. It checks boxes for what feels like an older audience who misses the days when action movies were made about American heroes instead of super ones. Honestly, those movie watchers deserve better too. Other information about this film. The Bourne movies revivified the espionage genre with their nimble, scrappy, down and dirty action. But they weren't as widely imitated as one might have expected, which leaves The Contractor feeling like a relatively fresh chip off a not-so-old block. Chris Pine stars as a forcibly decommissioned U.S. Army careerist whom financial straits push him into a sketchy private militaristic security job. Needless to say, that goes south in a hurry. Swede Tarik Sale's first American feature is more impersonally commercial than prior projects, and more efficient than memorable as a medium-scaled adventure exercise. Still, being a solid cut above average is good enough, given so much formulaic mediocrity among thrillers cluttering the streaming market. Already released in several territories during March, the film is scheduled for launch to US theaters, digital and on-demand platforms April 1st. Things start out unpromisingly in a rote mode of I love my flag and family sentiments underlining that Special Forces Sergeant James Harper is a straight-up good guy. He's just out of rehab for a serious injury incurred during the last of four combat rotations in 5 years, all of which has kept him overmuch from the wife and son he adores. But called into Fort Bragg by the brass, he's brusquely informed that due to a filthy drug test result, he'd been medicating for his painful knee. He is being discharged, effective immediately. It's an honorable, yet his pension, healthcare, and other benefits are abruptly gone along with the paycheck. Creditors were already closing in, so this is not just a bitter injustice, but a financial catastrophe. James has little choice but to hit up a close buddy, his former officer Mike, for leads on the kind of private contractor work he'd sworn he'd never do. As it happens, Mike is currently in the lucrative employ of one Rusty Jennings, whose coffee import-export business is a cover for for-hire covert operations manned by service personnel who have been chewed up and spat out just like our hero. Rusty makes a point of differentiating himself in profane terms from the likes of real-life Blackwater founder Eric Prince, suggesting he, by contrast, solely does the right thing. We deal strictly with matters of national security. He assures, the price is certainly right. A $50,000 check gets cut for James even before he starts. Soon he's on a plane to Berlin, where he spends several days spying on Salim Mohsen, a Harvard-educated virologist purportedly involved in bioterrorism research funded by Al-Qaeda affiliate. Then he, Mike and local contact Keisha execute a nocturnal raid of the lab facility, providing this action movie its first real action, well past the half-hour mark. Their mission somewhat messily accomplished, however, they're faced with a police phalanx. After a shootout, James is left alone, weakened and increasingly aware of the extent to which he has been double-crossed. It is this midsection that is the film's strongest suit, as our hero is hunted by both government forces and his own erstwhile allies. More a classic leading man type than a credibly hardened military lifer, Pine nonetheless has the physicality to convince us James can roll with various very hard punches here. Whether underwater, in subterranean tunnels, or at a crowded intersection turned second bullet-riddled melee, his survival strategies are nicely drawn in J.P. Davis' screenplay, and staged with tense but non-hyperbolic resourcefulness by Sale in well-chosen locations. Things slow down a bit when James finds brief refuge in the unlikely form of Eddie Marsan, while the remaining story beats grow more predictable, but satisfying enough nonetheless. Those hoping Pine and the always welcome Foster's reunion would be the class of hell or high water should lower those expectations considerably. Most of the overqualified supporting actors are too briefly seen to be made much use of, with Haas particularly wasted. Still, The Contractor succeeds as a locked and loaded intrigue sufficiently grounded in plausible mercenary-style chicanery worldwide. And that industry's exploitation of ex-military personnel, while avoiding any heavy political messaging. Of course, Eric Prince may disagree, ostensibly set mostly in Germany. The well-turned production manages to pass muster with a disguised, primarily Romanian shoot. DP Pierre Aim's widescreen images and editor Thais Schmidt's pacing are adept, while Alex Belcher's original score is at its most effective when stripped down to an urgent electronic pulse. More details, for me. There is nothing in this world more important than protecting and providing for those I love most, which is exactly why Chris Pine's new military drama The Contractor hits so close to home. Even if, like me, you can't relate to the career background of Pine's Special Forces Sergeant James Harper, there's a lot that resonates in his painful story and the unfair cards he's dealt. And Pine's performance shines through as he carries the heavy weight of his character's past on screen. Even though the ending and certain action scenes fell a little short of the high bar set by the rest of the film, James Harper's journey remains a largely compelling one. Refreshingly, instead of jumping straight into the action and explosions as some military thrillers tend to do, it spends nearly an hour setting the scene before a single bullet is fired. That time is spent introducing us to Pines James, his wife Brian, and their son Jack, showing a loving family whose happy lifestyle is being threatened by ever-growing debt and an honorable discharge that James wanted no part in. Fans of edge-of-your-seat gunfights need not worry as the contractor eventually has plenty of them. But the time it takes at the beginning grounds the story, the stakes, and it lends much more meaning to what happens next. Even scenes that might play out as casual pillow talk demonstrate what's at stake here, including one where Brian and James discuss the death of a friend who was also in the military. It is presented as not some shocking revelation, but instead as a regular part of their lives, and the normalcy with which they talk about it makes it ever more disturbing. It's moments like these, coupled with shots of James and Jack playing in the backyard or being filmed by Brian in the pool, that paint a picture of a family with a pretty universal want to live their lives free of struggle and tragedy. It gives the contractor a certain amount of relatability in what could have been instead have been 103 minutes of bullets flying with far fewer emotional stakes. This effort is aided by its cast, and Pine was a more than worthy choice for the lead. Pine sinks with the weight of a life filled with pain, both mental and physical, in large part due to a severe knee injury and the fallout from a toxic relationship with a father he is trying not to become, and he portrays Harper's heavy baggage wonderfully. He was also clearly up to the task when it came to the action scenes, as I never questioned whether he was a soldier who had committed his whole life to perfecting his lethal skills. Ben Foster, who plays James' best friend and former superior, is another standout in The Contractor. The chemistry between them that we've seen in prior collaborations like Hell or High Water is on full display, selling a brotherly trust and banter that extends far beyond the story that's on the surface. Kiefer Sutherland, meanwhile, plays Rusty, the leader of a team running covert, off-the-book missions to protect national security alongside the seemingly lovely Spring Lake Coffee Roastery. It's no fault of Sutherland's, who, on the surface, fits perfectly into the role of a gruff and seasoned vet with a heart, but this character ends up as one of the film's weaker aspects. Rusty doesn't get enough screen time to become anything more than two-dimensional, standing as a pretty thin element in an otherwise layered story, which could also be said of the ending. It's hard to discuss without getting too deep into spoilers, but I was left feeling conflicted as the credits rolled, and not in a great way. The way it all wrapped up felt a little too tidy. And that's not to say James and co. saw a happy or sad conclusion or anything in between. Instead, the final moments simply felt at odds with the rest of the film. It didn't feel truly earned, happened way too quickly, and left little to imagination. All that aside, the journey to that underwhelming conclusion is an exciting one, filled with mostly solid action, shocking twists, and a mirror that presents us with a simple question: are you sure everything is as it seems? It's no spoiler to say that the answer is clearly no, or we wouldn't have much of a film. But there are plenty of surprises and adrenaline-filled moments that more than make up for that obvious truth. On that note, while many of the action scenes carried the heft of a big-budget blockbuster, others weren't quite as sleek and briefly took me out of the immersion. There was one close-quarters fight in particular that gave me a headache with how many jump cuts there were, some of which would cut away too fast and return farther ahead than they logically should have. Another scene saw a veteran making a very questionable decision for someone of his experience level, followed by a fist fight where a few blows that sounded like they hit the target clearly missed on screen. In the end, however, The Contractor is more memorable for the focus it puts on the people and families impacted by war, and it's all the better for it. While any particular fight in the movie might not be discussed years down the line, its message, one about the hard truths its characters are forced to learn, and the willingness to give everything for those you love, is timeless. Positive elements. If James takes pride in his military service, his greatest joys are actually back home, his wife, Brian, and his son, Jack. It's not easy being a family man and a military man. We hear some sad stories of soldiers leaving their families, and James never wanted to be such a story himself. He made a promise, he tells someone, "Never forsake my family," and he means it. James begins to question his marching orders, too. The movie doesn't quite answer whether he would have fought against the nefarious plot that's been set in motion if he didn't have to. He was as much fighting to survive as to rectify any wrongs. But the fact that he does battle against some pretty terrible goals should still be lauded. Spiritual elements. James seems to be a man of faith, as are others in the film. He's in church when the pastor blesses a trio of soldiers as they head off on assignment. "May God bless you and protect you," the pastor says, praying over the soldiers as the rest of the congregation also bows their heads. Only James stares forward, lost in thought, as if wishing he could go, too. When Mike invites James for dinner, Mike's family clasps hands for a dinnertime blessing. Thank you for this food, and thank you for bringing Uncle James back safely. Mike says, James shares a dinnertime prayer with an unexpected rescuer, too. The scientist, Salim Mohammed Mohsen, is rumored to have connections with Al-Qaeda. But when James talks with him, he says, I don't believe in God. I believe in science. Someone compares a mission locale with Eden, and says its mountains looked like they were holding up heaven. Sexual content. James and his wife kiss once or twice, including when James briefly cuddles up with her in bed. It's not a sexual scene. He simply gives her a check, an advance on his contract work, and essentially says goodbye. We see James shirtless several times. In one scene, he lies in a bathtub, and the camera views him from the side, a gun resting on his exposed hip. Violent content. As you might expect, The Contractor is plenty violent, and we are exposed to some graphic scenes. In one such scene, a man bashes another to death with a rock. While we don't see most of the blows, we do see the victim's head afterwards, looking as much like a rotting cabbage as it does an identifiable face. Other deaths are less grotesque, though we do see several people shot through the head. The deaths are accompanied by sprays of blood. Victims are shot elsewhere, and some die. The shootout with police leaves several lifeless people strewn on the ground. Other gunshot victims bleed slowly from their midsections, leaving clothes and hands bloody. Some eventually bleed out, though James saves one by transfusing some of his own blood into the victim. Characters die via explosion. One motorcycle rider gets struck with a cinder block. Another is stabbed in the gut and spends several movie minutes slumped helplessly against a wall. A man apparently dies after being injected with a drug underneath a fingernail. Evidence of how he died is covered up with a dramatic explosion, which also kills a security guard and loads of laboratory animals. James' injured knee is pretty grotesque. We see just how bad it is, and we learn that he aggravates the injury during the course of his adventures. Sometimes he's forced to stick a syringe in the thing to suck out fluid building up there. A young boy receives a real tattoo for his birthday, and he suffers through the procedure. Threats are made. A vehicle is set on fire. A man gets knocked out via an injection. We hear about the suicide of a fellow ranger, and it's suggested his self-inflicted death isn't the first one that James and his family have had to deal with. Such deaths, it seems, are euphemistically dealt with by telling others that the soldier died in his sleep. Drug and alcohol content. The scientist smokes. James and Mike share a beer after dinner one evening, and Mike suggests they go out for another once the current mission is over. James takes a number of drugs to deal with the pain in his knee. We see him pop pills and inject himself with some sort of drug. When James gets called in to face his new commanding officer, he's told that his blood is filthy with evidence of the stuff. Other negative elements. James lies to his wife about his job, telling her that he'll be just babysitting corporate executives. Not dangerous at all, he says, though she knows he's lying. Lies and betrayal are an integral part of the titular contractor's plot, though the movie certainly doesn't condone either. Conclusion. The Contractor deals, slightly, with the entwined issues of physical trauma and mental health in the military. James, we see, is struggling with both. His knee is torn apart. His mind, the movie suggests, is slowly crumbling. His wife finds him on the family roof in the middle of the night, putting a few more shingles in it before the weather comes. After James and Mike go to the funeral of a fellow ranger who committed suicide, Mike asks James how he's doing. I'm fine, James says. Mike reminds him that that's just what their late friend said, too, right before he took his own life. Rusty even uses that trauma as a selling tool for James. We gave our minds, our bodies, our spirits, and they chewed us up and spit us out. It's okay, James is told, to use the skills the military gave him for a big payday or two. It's okay to cash in, Mike tells him. But let's not mistake The Contractor for an issues-related think pick, setting those fairly superficial ruminations aside. This is a straightforward, R-rated actioner, frenetic and profane and, at times, pretty bloody. The Contractor does want us to consider the issues of mental health in the military. It seems, gratifyingly, to understand the importance of faith to many who serve. But the story is more about prey than prayer, and the movie's many predators take down many a person, both innocent and guilty, with extreme prejudice. This film directed by Tarik Saleh, written by J.P. Davis, produced by Basil Iwanyk, Erica Lee, starring Chris Pine, Ben Foster, Gillian Jacobs, Eddie Marsan, J.D. Pardo, Florian Montinu, Kiefer Sutherland, cinematography, Pierre Aim, edited by Thais Schmidt, music by Alex Belcher, production companies, Thunder Road Films, 30 West, distributed by Paramount Pictures, STXfilms, release date, April 1, 2022, running time, 103 minutes, country, United States, language, English, box office, $2.1 million. The Contractor is a 2022 American action thriller film directed by Tarik Saleh in his English-language film debut. The film stars Chris Pine, Ben Foster, Gillian Jacobs, Eddie Marsan, J.D. Pardo, Florian Montinu, and Kiefer Sutherland. Filming began in Europe in October 2019. It also filmed in Fort Bragg and wrapped at the end of 2019. The Contractor was released in theaters and on demand in the United States on April 1, 2022, by Paramount Pictures and STXfilms. The film received mixed reviews from critics, grossing $2.1 million at the box office. Movie plot: Sergeant First Class James Harper, a decorated Green Beret, is involuntarily discharged from the Army due to his use of illegal steroids to treat a debilitating knee injury. Facing financial ruin, he contacts his friend Mike, who works with a private military company under the command of fellow veteran Rusty Jennings. Harper is receiving lucrative offers from similar firms, but feels a sense of duty to his country. Mike tells him that Rusty runs clandestine operations for the Department of Defense. Harper agrees to meet Rusty after seeing Mike's opulent house. Harper signs on with Rusty and the team for an operation in Germany. As a sign of good faith, Rusty gives Harper's family $50,000 to help clear their debts. Harper spends most of his tour surveilling a Middle Eastern scientist named Saleh. After analyzing the data, Rusty informs the team that Saleh is working for Al-Qaeda and developing a bio-agent. He tells the team they have been given permission to raid Saleh's laboratory and retrieve all of his research data and then dispose of Saleh. The team easily accesses the lab and acquires the data. Mike orders Harper to finish Saleh, who protests that he is just a scientist working on a cure. Harper follows orders and then departs after setting the lab on fire, carrying Saleh's laptop containing the research data. The team are confronted by the police, and after a prolonged shootout, during which the remaining team members are killed, Harper rescues a wounded Mike and they hide in a nearby storm drain. Mike, believing he is about to die, begs Harper to look after his family and get the data to Rusty. Harper provides a blood transfusion and saves Mike's life. After recuperating, Mike is ready to return to Rusty and the main team, but Harper's knee has given out on him and he needs to rest up. Mike proceeds alone with Saleh's laptop but informs Harper he will be picked up from a specific location after he is sufficiently rested. Harper makes it to the hotel and finds fresh clothes and a note from Mike saying that he went to hand off the laptop. He tries to treat his injured knee and waits for Mike to return. When Mike doesn't come back, Harper leaves the hotel, gets a burner phone, and makes contact with Rusty, who informs him there is a car waiting to exfiltrate him to safety. But Harper senses something is amiss when Rusty tells him that Mike never made it to Berlin. As he delays going to the car, a hit team emerges and they shoot at Harper. Harper evades capture and manages to kill the hit team, who are revealed to be former recon Marines working for Rusty. Before dying, one of the Marines gives Harper intel on a safe house but advises him that he can never return home. Harper visits Saleh's home, threatening Sylvie, Saleh's wife, into providing him with Saleh's computer files. Sylvie gives Harper her husband's iPad, and he leaves for the safe house. After Harper meets Virgil, he is tranquilized and awakens in the safe house. Virgil explains that Harper's knee was infected, and that while it has been treated, Harper still cannot return to his family. Harper plays a video on the iPad in which Saleh explains that he was indeed working on a successful H5N1 vaccine formula that he intends to provide for free, rather than sell to a pharmaceutical company. While Virgil shares dinner with Harper, another of Rusty's fire teams attacks. Virgil is killed, but Harper escapes, setting off a booby trap for Rusty's team. Harper returns to the United States. He tracks down Mike, who explains that Rusty also lied to him and told him Harper had died. Rusty has provided for Harper's family, and Mike advises Harper to disappear. Harper protests. Winning his old friend over, they set up a plan to get revenge on Rusty. Mike gets Harper into Rusty's compound, where they surprise Rusty's guards. While Mike distracts everyone with a frontal attack, Harper infiltrates Rusty's house. Harper manages to terminate Rusty, but not before Rusty has mortally wounded Mike. Harper is finally able to return to his family. Cast: Chris Pine as James Harper, Ben Foster as Mike Hawkins, Gillian Jacobs as Brian Harper, Eddie Marsan as Virgil, J.D. Pardo as Eric, Kiefer Sutherland as Rusty Jennings, Florian Montinu as Kaufman, Nina Haas as Keisha, Amira Kassar as Sylvie, Fares Fares as Saleh. Production: The project was announced in May 2019 as Violence of Action, with Chris Pine set to star. In October, Ben Foster and Gillian Jacobs joined the cast. Filming started in October 2019 in the United States and continued in Germany and Romania later in the year. The film is produced by Basil Iwanyk and Erica Lee from Thunder Road Films, with Esther Hornstein co-producing. Executive producers includes 30 West's Dan Friedkin, Micah Green and Dan Steinman, along with Pine, Jonathan Fuhman, Tom Lassily and Josh Bratman. In November 2019, filming in Romania started for around 8 weeks. By December 2019, Eddie Marsan, Nina Haas, Amira Kassar, Fares Fares and J.D. Pardo had joined the film. Filming wrapped by the end of 2019. In November 2021, it was reported that the film had been red-idled. The Contractor. Alex Belcher composed the film's score. Sony Classical released the soundtrack. Release. In February 2021, STXfilms acquired distribution rights to the film. The movie was originally scheduled for release on December 10, 2021, but the release was delayed to March 18, 2022, and then to April 1, 2022. In February 2022, it was announced Paramount Pictures and Showtime acquired distribution rights to the film. Paramount will release the film in a simultaneous limited theatrical and premium video on demand release, with the film coming to Paramount Plus and Showtime later in the year. The rights for the film were put in bankruptcy on March 22, 2022, with Migration LLC now owning all worldwide rights to the film excluding United States. The film debuted on Prime Video in select countries on the same day as the US premiere. Box office. In the United States and Canada, The Contractor was released alongside Morbius and was projected to gross less than $1 million from 489 theaters in its opening weekend. It made $560,678 in its first 3 days, finishing 12th at the box office. It added $140,193 in its second weekend. Critical response. The review aggregator Rotten Tomatoes reported an approval rating of 44% based on 88 reviews, with an average rating of 5.5/10. The website's critics' consensus reads, "The Contractor is caught between message movie and standard-issue action thriller, satisfying neither aim despite strong work from a talented cast." Metacritic assigned the film a weighted average score of 52 out of 100 based on 19 critics, indicating mixed or average reviews. The Contractor movie review. There's a lot of discussion lately about the type of films that are released now and what it says about the future of movie. Is it true that all people will go to see in theaters are superhero movies and other familiar IP? If that's the case, my suspicion is that films like The Contractor will become commonplace on streaming services. There's ample evidence that programming old-fashioned series and movies, what could be called dad product, works to find an underserved, usually older fan base who can afford all the streamers. The success of shows like Yellowstone and Bosch means people will probably be drawn to an action movie that not only recalls the time that star Chris Pine played Jack Ryan but reunites the stars of Hell or High Water. Sadly, the promise of The Contractor fizzles after an intriguing setup as the script feels beneath most of the people involved. The talented cast do just enough to make this one more forgettable than horrendous, which means The Contractor 2 seems likely, and so many more movies like it. I hope some of them try harder. The always solid Pine plays Special Forces Sergeant James Harper, an elite agent with a bum knee who gets discharged from the US Army and watches the bills pile up with his wife Brian. That's when his former squadmate and good friend Mike reaches out with a proposal. Mike has been doing off-the-books operations for a veteran named Rusty Jennings. The money is good, the jobs are quick, and it will give James purpose again while providing for his family. As Mike says, we're all just mercenaries in the end, giving the opening act of The Contractor some weighty dramatic material that the rest of the film doesn't fulfill. It's easy to think about the last time Pine and Foster starred in a drama that hinged on the lie of the American dream. If Hell or High Water was the Western version of that concept, this is the Tom Clancy-inspired one. The problem is that writer J.P. Davis and director Tarik Saleh seem afraid to do anything interesting or unexpected once they have their pieces in place. It's not surprising at all that the mission that James and Mike are contracted for blows up in their face. And only people who have never seen a movie before will be surprised to learn that Rusty isn't telling them everything they need to know. Ultimately, The Contractor becomes depressingly routine. The action isn't interestingly staged, and the plot has less twists in its 100 minutes than your average single episode of a spy drama. It all feels like setup, getting people ready for a series of a film franchise, but so narratively thin on its own that you could recount the plot in like 15 words or less. This all means that the cast has to do a lot of heavy lifting to get this bare-bones film to 2 stars, which they do. They're the real mercenaries here as Pine finds a sadness that balances the heroic approach lesser actors would have taken and proves he still has great chemistry with Foster. Nina Haas is sadly wasted in a small part, but Eddie Marsan gets a great scene that breaks the tedium of the second half with its near-capture, escape structure as James tries to find his way home. Other than a remarkable lack of ambition, there's nothing explicitly wrong or dreadful about The Contractor. It checks boxes for what feels like an older audience who misses the days when action movies were made about American heroes instead of super ones. Honestly, those movie watchers deserve better too. Other information about this film. The Bourne movies revivified the espionage genre with their nimble, scrappy, down and dirty action. But they weren't as widely imitated as one might have expected, which leaves The Contractor feeling like a relatively fresh chip off a not-so-old block. Chris Pine stars as a forcibly decommissioned U.S. Army careerist whom financial straits push him into a sketchy private militaristic security job. Needless to say, that goes south in a hurry. Swede Tarik Sale's first American feature is more impersonally commercial than prior projects, and more efficient than memorable as a medium-scaled adventure exercise. Still, being a solid cut above average is good enough, given so much formulaic mediocrity among thrillers cluttering the streaming market. Already released in several territories during March, the film is scheduled for launch to US theaters, digital and on-demand platforms April 1st. Things start out unpromisingly in a rote mode of I love my flag and family sentiments underlining that Special Forces Sergeant James Harper is a straight-up good guy. He's just out of rehab for a serious injury incurred during the last of four combat rotations in 5 years, all of which has kept him overmuch from the wife and son he adores. But called into Fort Bragg by the brass, he's brusquely informed that due to a filthy drug test result, he'd been medicating for his painful knee. He is being discharged, effective immediately. It's an honorable, yet his pension, healthcare, and other benefits are abruptly gone along with the paycheck. Creditors were already closing in, so this is not just a bitter injustice, but a financial catastrophe. James has little choice but to hit up a close buddy, his former officer Mike, for leads on the kind of private contractor work he'd sworn he'd never do. As it happens, Mike is currently in the lucrative employ of one Rusty Jennings, whose coffee import-export business is a cover for for-hire covert operations manned by service personnel who have been chewed up and spat out just like our hero. Rusty makes a point of differentiating himself in profane terms from the likes of real-life Blackwater founder Eric Prince, suggesting he, by contrast, solely does the right thing. We deal strictly with matters of national security. He assures, the price is certainly right. A $50,000 check gets cut for James even before he starts. Soon he's on a plane to Berlin, where he spends several days spying on Salim Mohsen, a Harvard-educated virologist purportedly involved in bioterrorism research funded by Al-Qaeda affiliate. Benny, Mike, and local contact Keisha execute a nocturnal raid of the lab facility, providing this action movie its first real action, well past the half-hour mark. Their mission somewhat messily accomplished. However, they're faced with a police phalanx. After a shootout, James is left alone, weakened and increasingly aware of the extent to which he has been double-crossed. It is this midsection that is the film's strongest suit, as our hero is hunted by both government forces and his own erstwhile allies. More a classic leading man type than a credibly hardened military lifer, Pine nonetheless has the physicality to convince us James can roll with various very hard punches here, whether underwater, in subterranean tunnels, or at a crowded intersection turned second bullet-riddled melee. His survival strategies are nicely drawn in J.P. Davis' screenplay, and staged with tense but non-hyperbolic resourcefulness by Sale and well-chosen locations. Things slow down a bit when James finds brief refuge in the unlikely form of Eddie Marsan, while the remaining story beats grow more predictable, but satisfying enough nonetheless. Those hoping Pine and the always welcome Foster's reunion would be the class of hell or high water should lower those expectations considerably. Most of the overqualified supporting actors are too briefly seen to be made much use of, with Haas particularly wasted. Still, the contractor succeeds as a locked and loaded intrigue sufficiently grounded in plausible mercenary-style chicanery worldwide. And that industry's exploitation of ex-military personnel, while avoiding any heavy political messaging. Of course, Eric Prince may disagree, ostensibly set mostly in Germany. The well-turned production manages to pass muster with a disguised, primarily Romanian shoot. DP Pierre Ames' widescreen images and editor Thais Schmidt's pacing are adept, while Alex Belcher's original score is at its most effective when stripped down to an urgent electronic pulse. More details, for me. There is nothing in this world more important than protecting and providing for those I love most, which is exactly why Chris Pine's new military drama The Contractor hits so close to home. Even if, like me, you can't relate to the career background of Pine's Special Forces Sergeant James Harper, there's a lot that resonates in his painful story and the unfair cards he's dealt. And Pine's performance shines through as he carries the heavy weight of his character's past on screen. Even though the ending and certain action scenes fell a little short of the high bar set by the rest of the film, James Harper's journey remains a largely compelling one. Refreshingly, instead of jumping straight into the action and explosions as some military thrillers tend to do, it spends nearly an hour setting the scene before a single bullet is fired. That time is spent introducing us to Pine's James, his wife Brian, and their son Jack, showing a loving family whose happy lifestyle is being threatened by ever-growing debt and an honorable discharge that James wanted no part in. Fans of edge-of-your-seat gunfights need not worry as the contractor eventually has plenty of them, but the time it takes at the beginning grounds the story, the stakes, and it lends much more meaning to what happens next. Even scenes that might play out as casual pillow talk demonstrate what's at stake here, including one where Brian and James discuss the death of a friend who was also in the military. It is presented as not some shocking revelation, but instead as a regular part of their lives, and the normalcy with which they talk about it makes it ever more disturbing. It's moments like these, coupled with shots of James and Jack playing in the backyard or being filmed by Brian in the pool, that paint a picture of a family with a pretty universal want to live their lives free of struggle and tragedy. It gives the Contractor a certain amount of relatability in what could have been instead have been 103 minutes of bullets flying with far fewer emotional stakes. This effort is aided by its cast, and Pine was a more than worthy choice for the lead. Pine sinks with the weight of a life filled with pain, both mental and physical, in large part due to a severe knee injury and the fallout from a toxic relationship with a father he is trying not to become, and he portrays Harper's heavy baggage wonderfully. He was also clearly up to the task when it came to the action scenes, as I never questioned whether he was a soldier who had committed his whole life to perfecting his lethal skills. Ben Foster, who plays James' best friend and former superior, is another standout in The Contractor. The chemistry between them that we've seen in prior collaborations like Hell or High Water is on full display here, selling a brotherly trust and banter that extends far beyond the story that's on the surface. Kiefer Sutherland, meanwhile, plays Rusty, the leader of a team running covert, off-the-book missions to protect national security alongside the seemingly lovely Spring Lake Coffee Roastery. It's no fault of Sutherland's, who, on the surface, fits perfectly into the role of a gruff and seasoned vet with a heart, but this character ends up as one of the film's weaker aspects. Rusty doesn't get enough screen time to become anything more than two-dimensional, standing as a pretty thin element in an otherwise layered story, which could also be said of the ending. It's hard to discuss without getting too deep into spoilers, but I was left feeling conflicted as the credits rolled, and not in a great way. The way it all wrapped up felt a little too tidy. And that's not to say James and co. saw a happy or sad conclusion or anything in between. Instead, the final moments simply felt at odds with the rest of the film. It didn't feel truly earned, happened way too quickly, and left little to imagination. All that aside, the journey to that underwhelming conclusion is an exciting one, filled with mostly solid action, shocking twists, and a mirror that presents us with a simple question: are you sure everything is as it seems? It's no spoiler to say that the answer is clearly no, or we wouldn't have much of a film. But there are plenty of surprises and adrenaline-filled moments that more than make up for that obvious truth. On that note, while many of the action scenes carried the heft of a big-budget blockbuster, others weren't quite as sleek and briefly took me out of the immersion. There was one close-quarters fight in particular that gave me a headache with how many jump cuts there were, some of which would cut away too fast and return farther ahead than they logically should have. Another scene saw a veteran making a very questionable decision for someone of his experience level, followed by a fist fight where a few blows that sounded like they hit the target clearly missed on screen. In the end, however, The Contractor is more memorable for the focus it puts on the people and families impacted by war, and it's all the better for it. While any particular fight in the movie might not be discussed years down the line, its message, one about the hard truths its characters are forced to learn, and the willingness to give everything for those you love, is timeless. Positive elements. If James takes pride in his military service, his greatest joys are actually back home, his wife, Brian, and his son, Jack. It's not easy being a family man and a military man. We hear some sad stories of soldiers leaving their families, and James never wanted to be such a story himself. He made a promise, he tells someone, "Never forsake my family," and he means it. James begins to question his marching orders, too. The movie doesn't quite answer whether he would have fought against the nefarious plot that's been set in motion if he didn't have to. He was as much fighting to survive as to rectify any wrongs. But the fact that he does battle against some pretty terrible goals should still be lauded. Spiritual elements. James seems to be a man of faith, as are others in the film. He's in church when the pastor blesses a trio of soldiers as they head off on assignment. "May God bless you and protect you," the pastor says, praying over the soldiers as the rest of the congregation also bows their heads. Only James stares forward, lost in thought, as if wishing he could go, too. When Mike invites James for dinner, Mike's family clasps hands for a dinnertime blessing. "Thank you for this food, and thank you for bringing Uncle James back safely," Mike says. James shares a dinnertime prayer with an unexpected rescuer, too. The scientist, Salim Mohammed Mohsen, is rumored to have connections with Al-Qaeda. But when James talks with him, he says, "I don't believe in God. I believe in science." Someone compares a mission locale with Eden, and says its mountains look like they were holding up heaven. Sexual content. James and his wife kiss once or twice, including when James briefly cuddles up with her in bed. It's not a sexual scene. He simply gives her a check, an advance on his contract work, and essentially says goodbye. We see James shirtless several times. In one scene, he lies in a bathtub, and the camera views him from the side, a gun resting on his exposed hip. Violent content. As you might expect, the contractor is plenty violent, and we are exposed to some graphic scenes. In one such scene, a man bashes another to death with a rock. While we don't see most of the blows, we do see the victim's head afterwards, looking as much like a rotting cabbage as it does an identifiable face. Other deaths are less grotesque, though we do see several people shot through the head. The deaths are accompanied by sprays of blood. Victims are shot elsewhere, and some die. The shootout with police leaves several lifeless people strewn on the ground. Other gunshot victims bleed slowly from their midsections, leaving clothes and hands bloody. Some eventually bleed out, though James saves one by transfusing some of his own blood into the victim. Characters die via explosion. One motorcycle rider gets struck with a cinder block. Another is stabbed in the gut and spends several movie minutes slumped helplessly against a wall. A man apparently dies after being injected with a drug underneath a fingernail. Evidence of how he died is covered up with a dramatic explosion, which also kills a security guard and loads of laboratory animals. James' injured knee is pretty grotesque. We see just how bad it is, and we learn that he aggravates the injury during the course of his adventures. Sometimes he's forced to stick a syringe in the thing to suck out fluid building up there. A young boy receives a real tattoo for his birthday, and he suffers through the procedure. Threats are made. A vehicle is set on fire. A man gets knocked out via an injection. We hear about the suicide of a fellow ranger, and it's suggested his self-inflicted death isn't the first one that James and his family have had to deal with. Such deaths, it seems, are euphemistically dealt with by telling others that the soldier died in his sleep. Drug and alcohol content. The scientist smokes. James and Mike share a beer after dinner one evening, and Mike suggests they go out for another once the current mission is over. James takes a number of drugs to deal with the pain in his knee. We see him pop pills and inject himself with some sort of drug. When James gets called in to face his new commanding officer, he's told that his blood is filthy with evidence of the stuff. Other negative elements. James lies to his wife about his job, telling her that he'll be just babysitting corporate executives. Not dangerous at all, he says, though she knows he's lying. Lies and betrayal are an integral part of the titular contractor's plot, though the movie certainly doesn't condone either. Conclusion. The contractor deals, slightly, with the entwined issues of physical trauma and mental health in the military. James, we see, is struggling with both. His knee is torn apart. His mind, the movie suggests, is slowly crumbling. His wife finds him on the family roof in the middle of the night, putting a few more shingles in it before the weather comes. After James and Mike go to the funeral of a fellow ranger who committed suicide, Mike asks James how he's doing. I'm fine, James says. Mike reminds him that that's just what their late friend said, too, right before he took his own life. Rusty even uses that trauma as a selling tool for James. We gave our minds, our bodies, our spirits, and they chewed us up and spit us out. It's okay, James is told, to use the skills the military gave him for a big payday or two. It's okay to cash in, Mike tells him. But let's not mistake the contractor for an issues-related think pick, setting those fairly superficial ruminations aside. This is a straightforward, R-rated actioner, frenetic and profane and, at times, pretty bloody. The contractor does want us to consider the issues of mental health in the military. It seems, gratifyingly, to understand the importance of faith to many who serve. But the story is more about prey than prayer. And the movie's many predators take down many a person, both innocent and guilty, with extreme prejudice. This film directed by Tarik Saleh, written by J.P. Davis, produced by Basil Iwanyk, Erica Lee, starring Chris Pine, Ben Foster, Gillian Jacobs, Eddie Marsan, J.D. Pardo, Florian Montinu, Kiefer Sutherland, cinematography, Pierre Aim, edited by Thais Schmidt, music by Alex Belcher, production companies, Thunder Road Films, 30 West, distributed by Paramount Pictures, STXfilms, release date, April 1, 2022. Running time, 103 minutes. Country, United States. Language, English. Box office, $2.1 million. The Contractor is a 2022 American action thriller film directed by Tarik Saleh in his English language film debut. The film stars Chris Pine, Ben Foster, Gillian Jacobs, Eddie Marsan, J.D. Pardo, Florian Montinu, and Kiefer Sutherland. Filming began in Europe in October 2019. It also filmed in Fort Bragg and wrapped at the end of 2019. The Contractor was released in theaters and on demand in the United States on April 1, 2022, by Paramount Pictures and STXfilms. The film received mixed reviews from critics, grossing $2.1 million at the box office. Movie plot. Sergeant First Class James Harper, a decorated green beret, is involuntarily discharged from the army due to his use of illegal steroids to treat a debilitating knee injury. Facing financial ruin, he contacts his friend Mike, who works with a private military company under the command of fellow veteran Rusty Jennings. Harper is receiving lucrative offers from similar firms, but feels a sense of duty to his country. Mike tells him that Rusty runs clandestine operations for the Department of Defense. Harper agrees to meet Rusty after seeing Mike's opulent house. Harper signs on with Rusty and the team for an operation in Germany. As a sign of good faith, Rusty gives Harper's family $50,000 to help clear their debts. Harper spends most of his tour surveilling a Middle Eastern scientist named Saleh. After analyzing the data, Rusty informs the team that Saleh is working for Al-Qaeda and developing a bio-agent. He tells the team they have been given permission to raid Saleh's laboratory and retrieve all of his research data and then dispose of Saleh. The team easily accesses the lab and acquires the data. Mike orders Harper to finish Saleh, who protests that he is just a scientist working on a cure. Harper follows orders and then departs after setting the lab on fire, carrying Saleh's laptop containing the research data. The team are confronted by the police and after a prolonged shootout, during which the remaining team members are killed, Harper rescues a wounded Mike and they hide in a nearby storm drain. Mike, believing he is about to die, begs Harper to look after his family and get the data to Rusty. Harper provides a blood transfusion and saves Mike's life. After recuperating, Mike is ready to return to Rusty and the main team, but Harper's knee has given out on him, and he needs to rest up. Mike proceeds alone with Salem's laptop but informs Harper he will be picked up from a specific location after he is sufficiently rested. Harper makes it to the hotel and finds fresh clothes and a note from Mike saying that he went to hand off the laptop. He tries to treat his injured knee and waits for Mike to return. When Mike doesn't come back, Harper leaves the hotel, gets a burner phone, and makes contact with Rusty, who informs him there is a car waiting to exfiltrate him to safety. But Harper senses something is amiss when Rusty tells him that Mike never made it to Berlin. As he delays going to the car, a hit team emerges and they shoot at Harper. Harper evades capture and manages to kill the hit team, who are revealed to be former recon Marines working for Rusty. Before dying, one of the Marines gives Harper intel on a safe house but advises him that he can never return home. Harper visits Salem's home, threatening Sylvie, Salem's wife, into providing him with Salem's computer files. Sylvie gives Harper her husband's iPad, and he leaves for the safe house. After Harper meets Virgil, he is tranquilized and awakens in the safe house. Virgil explains that Harper's knee was infected, and that while it has been treated, Harper still cannot return to his family. Harper plays a video on the iPad in which Salem explains that he was indeed working on a successful H5N1 vaccine formula that he intends to provide for free, rather than sell to a pharmaceutical company. While Virgil shares dinner with Harper, another of Rusty's fire teams attacks. Virgil is killed, but Harper escapes, setting off a booby trap for Rusty's team. Harper returns to the United States. He tracks down Mike, who explains that Rusty also lied to him and told him Harper had died. Rusty has provided for Harper's family, and Mike advises Harper to disappear. Harper protests. Winning his old friend over, they set up a plan to get revenge on Rusty. Mike gets Harper into Rusty's compound, where they surprise Rusty's guards. While Mike distracts everyone with a frontal attack, Harper infiltrates Rusty's house. Harper manages to terminate Rusty, but not before Rusty has mortally wounded Mike. Harper is finally able to return to his family. Cast: Chris Pine as James Harper, Ben Foster as Mike Hawkins, Gillian Jacobs as Brian Harper, Eddie Marsan as Virgil, J.D. Pardo as Eric, Kiefer Sutherland as Rusty Jennings, Florian Montinu as Kaufman, Nina Haas as Keisha, Amira Kassar as Sylvie, Fares Fares as Salem. Production: The project was announced in May 2019 as Violence of Action, with Chris Pine set to star. In October, Ben Foster and Gillian Jacobs joined the cast. Filming started in October 2019 in the United States, and continued in Germany and Romania later in the year. The film is produced by Basil Iwanyk and Erica Lee from Thunder Road Films, with Esther Hornstein co-producing. Executive producers includes 30 West's Dan Friedkin, Micah Green and Dan Steinman, along with Pine, Jonathan Fuhrman, Tom Lassily and Josh Bratman. In November 2019, filming in Romania started for around 8 weeks. By December 2019, Eddie Marsan, Nina Haas, Amira Kassar, Fares Fares and J.D. Pardo had joined the film. Filming wrapped by the end of 2019. In November 2021, it was reported that the film had been red-idled. The Contractor: Alex Belcher composed the film's score. Sony Classical released the soundtrack. Release: In February 2021, STXfilms acquired distribution rights to the film. The movie was originally scheduled for release on December 10, 2021, but the release was delayed to March 18, 2022, and then to April 1, 2022. In February 2022, it was announced Paramount Pictures and Showtime acquired distribution rights to the film. Paramount will release the film in a simultaneous limited theatrical and premium video on demand release, with the film coming to Paramount Plus and Showtime later in the year. The rights for the film were put in bankruptcy on March 22, 2022, with Migration LLC now owning all worldwide rights to the film excluding United States. The film debuted on Prime Video in select countries on the same day as the US premiere. Box office. In the United States and Canada, The Contractor was released alongside Morbius and was projected to gross less than $1 million from 489 theaters in its opening weekend. It made $560,678 in its first 3 days, finishing 12th at the box office. It added $140,193 in its second weekend. Critical response. The review aggregator Rotten Tomatoes reported an approval rating of 44% based on 88 reviews, with an average rating of 5.5/10. The website's critics' consensus reads, "The Contractor is caught between message movie and standard-issue action thriller, satisfying neither aim despite strong work from a talented cast." Metacritic assigned the film a weighted average score of 52 out of 100 based on 19 critics, indicating mixed or average reviews. The Contractor movie review. There's a lot of discussion lately about the type of films that are released now and what it says about the future of movie. Is it true that all people will go to see in theaters are superhero movies and other familiar IP? If that's the case, my suspicion is that films like The Contractor will become commonplace on streaming services. There's ample evidence that programming old-fashioned series and movies, what could be called dad product, works to find an underserved, usually older fan base who can afford all the streamers. The success of shows like Yellowstone and Bosch means people will probably be drawn to an action movie that not only recalls the time that star Chris Pine played Jack Ryan but reunites the stars of Hell or High Water. Sadly, the promise of The Contractor fizzles after an intriguing setup as the script feels beneath most of the people involved. The talented cast do just enough to make this one more forgettable than horrendous, which means The Contractor 2 seems likely, and so many more movies like it. I hope some of them try harder. The always solid Pine plays Special Forces Sergeant James Harper, an elite agent with a bum knee who gets discharged from the US Army and watches the bills pile up with his wife Brian. That's when his former squadmate and good friend Mike reaches out with a proposal. Mike has been doing off-the-books operations for a veteran named Rusty Jennings. The money is good, the jobs are quick, and it will give James purpose again while providing for his family. As Mike says, we're all just mercenaries in the end, giving the opening act of The Contractor some weighty dramatic material that the rest of the film doesn't fulfill. It's easy to think about the last time Pine and Foster starred in a drama that hinged on the lie of the American dream. If Hell or High Water was the Western version of that concept, this is the Tom Clancy-inspired one. The problem is that writer J.P. Davis and director Tarik Saleh seem afraid to do anything interesting or unexpected once they have their pieces in place. It's not surprising at all that the mission that James and Mike are contracted for blows up in their face. And only people who have never seen a movie before will be surprised to learn that Rusty isn't telling them everything they need to know. Ultimately, The Contractor becomes depressingly routine. The action isn't interestingly staged, and the plot has less twists in its 100 minutes than your average single episode of a spy drama. It all feels like setup, getting people ready for a series of a film franchise, but so narratively thin on its own that you could recount the plot in like 15 words or less. This all means that the cast has to do a lot of heavy lifting to get this bare-bones film to 2 stars, which they do. They're the real mercenaries here as Pine finds a sadness that balances the heroic approach lesser actors would have taken and proves he still has great chemistry with Foster. Nina Haas is sadly wasted in a small part, but Eddie Marsan gets a great scene that breaks the tedium of the second half with its near-capture, escape structure as James tries to find his way home. Other than a remarkable lack of ambition, there's nothing explicitly wrong or dreadful about The Contractor. It checks boxes for what feels like an older audience who misses the days when action movies were made about American heroes instead of super ones. Honestly, those movie watchers deserve better too. Other information about this film. The Bourne movies revivified the espionage genre with their nimble, scrappy, down and dirty action. But they weren't as widely imitated as one might have expected, which leaves The Contractor feeling like a relatively fresh chip off a not-so-old block. Chris Pine stars as a forcibly decommissioned U.S. Army careerist whom financial straits push him into a sketchy private militaristic security job. Needless to say, that goes south in a hurry. Swede Tarik Saleh's first American feature is more impersonally commercial than prior projects, and more efficient than memorable as a medium-scaled adventure exercise. Still, being a solid cut above average is good enough, given so much formulaic mediocrity among thrillers cluttering the streaming market. Already released in several territories during March, the film is scheduled for launch to US theaters, digital and on-demand platforms April 1st. Things start out unpromisingly in a rote mode of I love my flag and family sentiments underlining that Special Forces Sergeant James Harper is a straight-up good guy. He's just out of rehab for a serious injury incurred during the last of 4 combat rotations in 5 years, all of which has kept him overmuch from the wife and son he adores. But called into Fort Bragg by the brass, he's brusquely informed that due to a filthy drug test result, he'd been medicating for his painful knee. He is being discharged, effective immediately. It's an honorable, yet his pension, healthcare, and other benefits are abruptly gone along with the paycheck. Creditors were already closing in, so this is not just a bitter injustice, but a financial catastrophe. James has little choice but to hit up a close buddy, his former officer Mike, for leads on the kind of private contractor work he'd sworn he'd never do. As it happens, Mike is currently in the lucrative employ of one Rusty Jennings, whose coffee import-export business is a cover for for-hire covert operations manned by service personnel who have been chewed up and spat out just like our hero. Rusty makes a point of differentiating himself in profane terms from the likes of real-life Blackwater founder Eric Prince, suggesting he, by contrast, solely does the right thing. We deal strictly with matters of national security. He assures, the price is certainly right. A $50,000 check gets cut for James even before he starts. Soon he's on a plane to Berlin, where he spends several days spying on Salim Mosin, a Harvard-educated virologist purportedly involved in bioterrorism research funded by Al-Qaeda affiliate. Then he, Mike and local contact Keisha execute a nocturnal raid of the lab facility, providing this action movie its first real action, well past the half-hour mark. Their mission somewhat messily accomplished, however, they're faced with a police phalanx. After a shootout, James is left alone, weakened and increasingly aware of the extent to which he has been double-crossed. It is this midsection that is the film's strongest suit, as our hero is hunted by both government forces and his own erstwhile allies. More a classic leading man type than a credibly hardened military lifer, Pine nonetheless has the physicality to convince us James can roll with various very hard punches here, whether underwater, in subterranean tunnels, or at a crowded intersection turned second bullet-riddled melee. His survival strategies are nicely drawn in J.P. Davis' screenplay, and staged with tense but non-hyperbolic resourcefulness by Saleh and well-chosen location. Things slow down a bit when James finds brief refuge in the unlikely form of Eddie Marsan, while the remaining story beats grow more predictable, but satisfying enough nonetheless. Those hoping Pine and the always welcome Foster's reunion would be the class of hell or high water should lower those expectations considerably. Most of the overqualified supporting actors are too briefly seen to be made much use of, with Haas particularly wasted. Still, the contractor succeeds as a locked and loaded intrigue sufficiently grounded in plausible mercenary-style chicanery worldwide. And that industry's exploitation of ex-military personnel, while avoiding any heavy political messaging. Of course, Eric Prince may disagree, ostensibly set mostly in Germany. The well-turned production manages to pass muster with a disguise, primarily Romanian shoot. DP Pierre Aim's widescreen images and editor Thais Schmidt's pacing are adept, while Alex Belcher's original score is at its most effective when stripped down to an urgent electronic pulse. More details, for me. There is nothing in this world more important than protecting and providing for those I love most, which is exactly why Chris Pine's new military drama The Contractor hits so close to home. Even if, like me, you can't relate to the career background of Pine's Special Forces Sergeant James Harper, there's a lot that resonates in his painful story and the unfair cards he's dealt. And Pine's performance shines through as he carries the heavy weight of his character's past on screen. Even though the ending and certain action scenes fell a little short of the high bar set by the rest of the film, James Harper's journey remains a largely compelling one. Refreshingly, instead of jumping straight into the action and explosions as some military thrillers tend to do, it spends nearly an hour setting the scene before a single bullet is fired. That time is spent introducing us to Pine's James, his wife Brian, and their son Jack, showing a loving family whose happy lifestyle is being threatened by ever-growing debt and an honorable discharge that James wanted no part in. Fans of edge-of-your-seat gunfights need not worry as the contractor eventually has plenty of them. But the time it takes at the beginning grounds the story, the stakes, and it lends much more meaning to what happens next. Even scenes that might play out as casual pillow talk demonstrate what's at stake here, including one where Brian and James discuss the death of a friend who was also in the military. It is presented as not some shocking revelation, but instead as a regular part of their lives, and the normalcy with which they talk about it makes it ever more disturbing. It's moments like these, coupled with shots of James and Jack playing in the backyard or being filmed by Brian in the pool, that paint a picture of a family with a pretty universal want to live their lives free of struggle and tragedy. It gives the contractor a certain amount of relatability in what could have been instead have been 103 minutes of bullets flying with far fewer emotional stakes. This effort is aided by its cast, and Pine was a more than worthy choice for the lead. Pine sinks with the weight of a life filled with pain, both mental and physical, in large part due to a severe knee injury and the fallout from a toxic relationship with a father he is trying not to become, and he portrays Harper's heavy baggage wonderfully. He was also clearly up to the task when it came to the action scenes, as I never questioned whether he was a soldier who had committed his whole life to perfecting his lethal skills. Ben Foster, who plays James' best friend and former superior, is another standout in The Contractor. The chemistry between them that we've seen in prior collaborations like Hell or High Water is on full display, selling a brotherly trust and banter that extends far beyond the story that's on the surface. Kiefer Sutherland, meanwhile, plays Rusty, the leader of a team running covert, off-the-book missions to protect national security alongside the seemingly lovely Spring Lake Coffee Roastery. It's no fault of Sutherland's, who, on the surface, fits perfectly into the role of a gruff and seasoned vet with a heart, but this character ends up as one of the film's weaker aspects. Rusty doesn't get enough screen time to become anything more than two-dimensional, standing as a pretty thin element in an otherwise layered story, which could also be said of the ending. It's hard to discuss without getting too deep into spoilers, but I was left feeling conflicted as the credits rolled, and not in a great way. The way it all wrapped up felt a little too tidy. And that's not to say James and co. saw a happy or sad conclusion or anything in between. Instead, the final moments simply felt at odds with the rest of the film. It didn't feel truly earned, happened way too quickly, and left little to imagination. All that aside, the journey to that underwhelming conclusion is an exciting one, filled with mostly solid action, shocking twists, and a mirror that presents us with a simple question: are you sure everything is as it seems? It's no spoiler to say that the answer is clearly no, or we wouldn't have much of a film. But there are plenty of surprises and adrenaline-filled moments that more than make up for that obvious truth. On that note, while many of the action scenes carried the heft of a big-budget blockbuster, others weren't quite as sleek and briefly took me out of the immersion. There was one close-quarters fight in particular that gave me a headache with how many jump cuts there were, some of which would cut away too fast and return farther ahead than they logically should have. Another scene saw a veteran making a very questionable decision for someone of his experience level, followed by a fist fight where a few blows that sounded like they hit the target clearly missed on screen. In the end, however, The Contractor is more memorable for the focus it puts on the people and families impacted by war, and it's all the better for it. While any particular fight in the movie might not be discussed years down the line, its message, one about the hard truths its characters are forced to learn, and the willingness to give everything for those you love, is timeless. Positive elements. If James takes pride in his military service, his greatest joys are actually back home, his wife, Brian, and his son, Jack. It's not easy being a family man and a military man. We hear some sad stories of soldiers leaving their families, and James never wanted to be such a story himself. He made a promise, he tells someone, "Never forsake my family," and he means it. James begins to question his marching orders, too. The movie doesn't quite answer whether he would have fought against the nefarious plot that's been set in motion if he didn't have to. He was as much fighting to survive as to rectify any wrongs. But the fact that he does battle against some pretty terrible goals should still be lauded. Spiritual elements. James seems to be a man of faith, as are others in the film. He's in church when the pastor blesses a trio of soldiers as they head off on assignment. "May God bless you and protect you," the pastor says, praying over the soldiers as the rest of the congregation also bows their heads. Only James stares forward, lost in thought, as if wishing he could go, too. When Mike invites James for dinner, Mike's family clasps hands for a dinnertime blessing. "Thank you for this food, and thank you for bringing Uncle James back safely," Mike says. James shares a dinnertime prayer with an unexpected rescuer, too. The scientist, Salim Mohammed Mohsen, is rumored to have connections with Al-Qaeda. But when James talks with him, he says, "I don't believe in God. I believe in science." Someone compares a mission locale with Eden, and says its mountains looked like they were holding up heaven. Sexual content. James and his wife kiss once or twice, including when James briefly cuddles up with her in bed. It's not a sexual scene. He simply gives her a check, an advance on his contract work, and essentially says goodbye. We see James shirtless several times. In one scene, he lies in a bathtub, and the camera views him from the side, a gun resting on his exposed hip. Violent content. As you might expect, The Contractor is plenty violent, and we are exposed to some graphic scenes. In one such scene, a man bashes another to death with a rock. While we don't see most of the blows, we do see the victim's head afterwards, looking as much like a rotting cabbage as it does an identifiable face. Other deaths are less grotesque, though we do see several people shot through the head. The deaths are accompanied by sprays of blood. Victims are shot elsewhere, and some die. The shootout with police leaves several lifeless people strewn on the ground. Other gunshot victims bleed slowly from their midsections, leaving clothes and hands bloody. Some eventually bleed out, though James saves one by transfusing some of his own blood into the victim. Characters die via explosion. One motorcycle rider gets struck with a cinder block. Another is stabbed in the gut and spends several movie minutes slumped helplessly against a wall. A man apparently dies after being injected with a drug underneath a fingernail. Evidence of how he died is covered up with a dramatic explosion, which also kills a security guard and loads of laboratory animals. James' injured knee is pretty grotesque. We see just how bad it is, and we learn that he aggravates the injury during the course of his adventures. Sometimes he's forced to stick a syringe in the thing to suck out fluid building up there. A young boy receives a real tattoo for his birthday, and he suffers through the procedure. Threats are made. A vehicle is set on fire. A man gets knocked out via an injection. We hear about the suicide of a fellow ranger, and it's suggested his self-inflicted death isn't the first one that James and his family have had to deal with. Such deaths, it seems, are euphemistically dealt with by telling others that the soldier died in his sleep. Drug and alcohol content. The scientist smokes. James and Mike share a beer after dinner one evening, and Mike suggests they go out for another once the current mission is over. James takes a number of drugs to deal with the pain in his knee. We see him pop pills and inject himself with some sort of drug. When James gets called in to face his new commanding officer, he's told that his blood is filthy with evidence of the stuff. Other negative elements. James lies to his wife about his job, telling her that he'll be just babysitting corporate executives. Not dangerous at all, he says, though she knows he's lying. Lies and betrayal are an integral part of the titular contractor's plot, though the movie certainly doesn't condone either. Conclusion. The Contractor deals, slightly, with the entwined issues of physical trauma and mental health in the military. James, we see, is struggling with both. His knee is torn apart. His mind, the movie suggests, is slowly crumbling. His wife finds him on the family roof in the middle of the night, putting a few more shingles in it before the weather comes. After James and Mike go to the funeral of a fellow ranger who committed suicide, Mike asks James how he's doing. I'm fine, James says. Mike reminds him that that's just what their late friend said, too, right before he took his own life. Rusty even uses that trauma as a selling tool for James. We gave our minds, our bodies, our spirits, and they chewed us up and spit us out. It's okay, James is told, to use the skills the military gave him for a big payday or two. It's okay to cash in, Mike tells him. But let's not mistake the contractor for an issues-related think pick, setting those fairly superficial ruminations aside. This is a straightforward, R-rated actioner, frenetic and profane and, at times, pretty bloody. The contractor does want us to consider the issues of mental health in the military. It seems, gratifyingly, to understand the importance of faith to many who serve. But the story is more about prey than prayer. And the movie's many predators take down many a person, both innocent and guilty, with extreme prejudice. This film directed by Tarik Saleh, written by J.P. Davis, produced by Basil Iwanyk, Erica Lee, starring Chris Pine, Ben Foster, Gillian Jacobs, Eddie Marsan, J.D. Pardo, Florian Montinu, Kiefer Sutherland, Cinematography, Pierre Aim, edited by Thais Schmidt, Music by Alex Belcher, Production Companies, Thunder Road Films, 30 West, distributed by Paramount Pictures, STXfilms, release date, April 1, 2022, running time, 103 minutes, country, United States. Language, English. Box office, $2.1 million. So guys, this is the review of the Contractor movie and some information about it. How do you like our today's video? Please let us know by commenting, and if you like this video, please like it, share it, and don't forget to subscribe.